Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's professional lunch at the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. I'm Anthony Rowley, a former president and acting as your moderator today. Our guest, as you know, is Keiko Tashiro, who is currently Executive Managing Director and Head of the Americas at Daiwa Securities Group here in Japan. Daiwa, as you know, is Japan's second largest brokerage, and Keiko-san, if I may call her that, is the first woman to work to be named as a board director of Daiwa. She's going to talk to us about the role of women in finance, or more specifically about the situation of female workers in Japan's financial sector. I personally don't need any convincing on the role of Asian women in finance, since my former wife, who is a Malaysian Chinese, now heads her own financial investment company in the City of London, having worked in a series of investment banks before that. And I should say she's a great deal richer and more successful than I am. But it seems to me that the very fact that we're talking today about women in finance in Japan, rather than simply taking it for granted that women will occupy senior positions in this and in other fields, is a sign of how far things still have to go in Japan and elsewhere before women are treated as a natural part of the workforce in any professional discipline. And in Japan, of course, it's not just a case of discrimination, but also of harassment against women, as the recent incident at the Tokyo Metropolitan Assembly, which was described here yesterday by Ms. Ayaka Shiomura, reminded us. But these problems of women's recognition go wider than Japan. And if you'll forgive me, I will just quote a little story recently, which was told by Christine Lagarde, who, as you know, is managing director of the IMF, and who is certainly a great advocate of women's empowerment and a role model for other women wanting to reach the top of their profession. She began a speech recently with what she called a well-known puzzle. A young boy, she said, is involved in a traffic accident and is immediately rushed to hospital for emergency treatment. In the bustle and chaos of the hospital environment, the surgeon strides into the operating theater. She said, think of a quintessential surgeon brimming with confidence and authority, a true type A personality who knows instinctively how to take charge. Yet this distinguished surgeon looks down at the boy and gasps and says, I can't operate on this boy, it's my son. Indeed, the boy is a surgeon's son, yet the surgeon is not the boy's father. What then? It's simple, said Miss Lagarde. The surgeon is a woman, and she is the boy's mother. I think that was a good example of how we tend to take sort of certain things for granted, that surgeons will always be men. Anyway, Japan's Prime Minister Shinzo Abe has promised to change the way that women are viewed under his womenomics policies, and Keiko-san will no doubt give us her analysis of how far there is still to go. Daiwa Securities, it seems, is more progressive than many others in its approach to women's professional empowerment. Ms. Tashiro joined the company Daiwa back in 1986, 28 years ago, which was the same year that the Equal Employment Opportunity Law went into effect here. She worked in Daiwa's International Investment Banking Division for a number of years, and then went on to earn an MBA degree at Stanford University in 1991. She's since held various positions at Daiwa throughout the world, including in Japan, in Singapore, and in London. In April 2009, she became Senior Managing Director and one of the first female executives in Daiwa. Then from 2011, she held the position of Global Head of Fixed Income, Currency, and Commodities. And then in April 2013, she was promoted to the position of Executive Managing Director, Head of the Americas of Daiwa Securities Group, Inc. Okay, well, I'll leave the introduction to that. Please join me in welcoming her. But before you do, please switch your Keitai Den, where your manner mode, telephones onto manner mode, or switch them off out of courtesy to the speaker. So please join me in welcoming Ms.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the great introduction. Can you hear me? I'm Keiko Tashiro, and I'm not going to dwell on what I've been doing before because of the introduction that was just made. Thank you for being here, and I just wanted to... don't want to break anything.
Do you want to further thought towards you? Maybe? Just a little bit. There we are, that's probably easier.
Okay, excuse me. So as you can probably guess from the introduction, my career at Daiwa has, if you listen to it, it would be pretty much the same as any of my male colleagues that joined the company at the same time. So I was mostly promoted more or less at the same time as my male colleagues. They sent me to business school. I've headed departments like fixed income that a lot of companies have men do. So on the surface, there hasn't been a lot of differences, but I just wanted to share with you some of what I did go through and some of it, of the changes and some of the things that I think are important in going forward, especially for my industry, because the finance industry, not just in Japan, but in New York, where I work right now, is still a big issue because there are not so many women in management and there is a lot of discrimination for no reason at all. So when I joined in 1986, I should start before that, I should start when I started looking for a job. When I entered Waseda in 1982, women had hardly any job opportunities. I was told that if I wanted a job and I wanted a serious job, I should start looking straight away. So in my freshman year, the first year I started at Waseda, I started job interviews. Probably very different. All my other colleagues were basically having the fun of their lives because, as you know, in school, in university, once you get in, you don't study. So that's what they were doing. I was actually going to job interviews. But the fact was that when I started, of course, there weren't so many companies that were thinking of hiring women. But then 1986, which is when the Equal Opportunities Act was going to come in effect, companies started saying in 1985, which is the real year I started looking for a job, is that they actually needed to hire women and to make, even if it was fake, that they were trying to comply with the new act. So I actually had to differentiate whether between the companies that were really thinking about hiring women and the companies that were just faking it. Because when I was looking for a job, the questions I was getting was appalling, and I wrote this appalling before what happened last week at the assembly at which was just mentioned, because at that time they would be asking questions like, what are you going to do when you get married, or they were looking at really pretty women, and they wanted to make sure that they had women that would make good wives for the male employees. They didn't really care about whether they were going to be capable career people or not, because that's what they were not. They were no intentions of doing that. It was said that it was easier to find a job if I graduated a junior college as opposed to a four-year school. As I mentioned, kotobushiki taisha, which is leaving or quitting after you get married, was the norm, and there are very few people that stayed on after getting married. So after I narrowed down the companies that I thought was going to be serious about trying to train me for a career, I ended up joining Daiwa Securities, and this is in 1986. But when I joined, there were actually five women out of probably about 250 men that were hired on the basis of pursuing a career. So there are five of us. Of the five, two of us went to go to the International Investment Banking Department in 1986 after a training session. We were the only two, other than the part-time people, that were not wearing a uniform. And our bosses didn't know what to do with us. But it wasn't just the bosses, it was everybody in the room, like the woman that was serving tea or were assistants. They didn't know if they should serve us tea or not at 9 o'clock and 3 o'clock. Because they didn't know whether we were supposed to be making copiers or whether we should be doing something else. And it was very, very awkward. And I should say that they ended up not serving us tea. And it was good that we were two of us, because otherwise it would have caused so many issues. And I can say this because a lot of companies, when they started hiring in 1986, they only put one person per division. And in these situations, a lot of them left because they didn't have anybody to talk to. So I was lucky that I had another person with me. But another thing that I was lucky was that this was just before the bubble era, and we were very, very busy. So they were so busy that they had to have these two women that joined working because they were up to there. But of course, when they started giving us jobs, we performed perfectly as well, or if not better, than all our male colleagues. And so they got used to it. But then we got to age 25. And I'm not sure if you know about this, but at that time, there was a saying that women are like a Christmas cake. So if you're not sold on the 25th or before the 25th, your value goes down by more than half if you're unsold. So companies were wary. And it was true that a lot of women left around 25. I don't know what the average age was to get married at that time, but a lot of companies were wary to put money into women because they left the company. But of course, a lot of women didn't intend to leave, but they were sort of forced out. And I felt that coming, even though it didn't come to me. And I thought, well, I have an opportunity to apply to business school, so why not take the chance? And I did apply, and I was given a scholarship. I should add that throughout this process, and the reason why I chose Daiwa was because the HR department was actually quite keen on making this sort of experiment succeed. So they would go out of their way to make sure that we were giving the equal opportunities. And one of the opportunities I was given was a scholarship to business school. So I went to Stanford in 1989 and came back in 1991. And I should say that while I was at business school, a lot of my female colleagues that joined, maybe not Daiwa, but other companies at the same time, left during that period and went to join foreign companies that were more accommodating. And I should also add that at that time, very different from now, men graduating Todai or Hitotsubashi did not even considering joining Goldman Sachs. They didn't think foreign companies were up to them, which is very different from now, because people graduating Todai would love to work for Goldman Sachs or Morgan Stanley or any other foreign company, as is Japanese companies, because they see the opportunities. But at that time, a lot of talented women did work for foreign companies, and they're still thriving right now. And after I came back, I worked for 2 years in Tokyo, and then I felt that maybe staying here is not a good idea, and I raised my hand and said I wanted to go work in Asia. I didn't say any country, but I said I wanted to work in Asia. And I was lucky again. They sent me to Singapore, and then they sent me to London. I was lucky for two reasons. One is, if I had stayed during that period in Japan, it would have been very difficult for me to sort of, my surroundings, my environment would have been difficult. The second is because London and Singapore are not as discriminatory towards women, I had all the chances and the environment. Even the Japanese men that were there knew that they had to treat women as equals, otherwise they wouldn't get anything done in the offices abroad. So I worked from in London until 1999, and as you know, this is when the Asian crisis hit in 98, and it was getting very difficult for Japanese financial institutions to operate abroad. And I thought, well, no, work isn't interesting, and I want to come back. So in 1999, I came back to Japan. By that time, I was 30-something, and nobody said that maybe I should get married anymore because they didn't think it was funny, and they kept quiet. But I was fine then. And all this, if you think in context of what happened at the Diet at the Tokyo Metropolitan Assembly, is still actually going on, and I think there is something, even though they know that they're not supposed to say it, it is still going on. But at this time, it was okay to say it out loud. Very disgusting. So when I came back, I was in investor relations, and then I went to the retail company, Daiwa Securities, which is the retail arm of our company. And there are a few things that I was lucky at that time, because in investment banking, it's a very male-dominated operations. Even if you look at the other U.S. institution, it is quite male-dominating. But if you go to the retail company, about 50% are women. And there's a reason why 50% are women. It's because their know-how and their knowledge and their experience is very, very important, of course, because 50% of our customers are women. And I think companies don't realize this or don't know what to do about it. But at Daiwa, and I think it was mentioned, our CEO at that time, not because there was a lack of men, but because he thought diversification and having women was important. He made a lot of decisions in making sure that women were able to continue on with their jobs, mainly if they needed to take time off to take care of their kids, or if their husbands or wives or their partners were going to be transferred to another part of the country, they could raise their hands and get transferred so they can stay as a family. And there are lots of various things that were put in place, probably maybe 10 years ago, that made it easier for women to continue working. And then 2009 came, and this is when I was made executive officer. At that time, I found it very difficult. I was the most youngest of the lot that was made executive officer, and I knew that I was one of the chosen. There were four women that were made executive officer at the same time, and I was the youngest, and I thought, well, I was probably chosen because I was a woman, and it had to be four rather than two, and I had all these reasons why I wasn't very happy about it. And of course, at that time, the press made a fuss about it because I was a woman, and there were four of us. And I think of the women that were made officers this year, and they probably, because it's 30 years since the Equal Opportunities Act, it is actually time that they became officers. It's not because Prime Minister Abe said they need to be more women in positions. So I feel actually a bit sorry for them, because even though they earned it and their male colleagues that were promoted at the same time, there's no big fuss. They seem to be said to be made executive because of Mr. Abe, not because. And I understand that, because that was how I felt in 2009. But at that time, there are four of us, and that was lucky because we could talk about amongst ourselves. And I think that was one of the reasons why I'm still here stress-free. And I also think that I would say this to all companies, that if you really, really thought that having women in executive positions was important and you were going to experiment trying putting them there, you shouldn't put all your eggs in one basket. And that's what a lot of companies are doing. They're choosing one woman, putting them in that position. And if they fail, they would say that experiment failed and I told you so. No, I don't want that to happen, but I can see that happening. And in any situation, if you're a financial institution, you never put all your eggs in one basket. You would diversify your bets. And I think that is what they actually need to do, but that's not happening. So that's a bit a real quick rundown of what I experienced. And I think some of you would think that, oh, yeah, but Japanese companies, if you in the past, women are having a very difficult time. But it is changing. And for me, and I think the challenges that women face right now are because at my age, a lot of women never perceived that they would want to become managers, and they were never trained to become managers. Because of, as I mentioned, women, they thought 20, 30 years ago that they would quit. So they never were trained properly to become managers. And this is the challenge that we're facing right now, and Mr. Abe, I think, is going to face, because he is saying that by 2020, 30% of women would be in managerial positions. But the fact is that they are not trained properly. And they are very talented, very, very smart. They're experienced in their own fields. But in terms of managing people, I think they don't have the experience. And one of the reasons why I was able to get the experience was because I worked abroad and because I went to business school. The women that are in positions like my age right now, they have been, a lot of them probably were marginalized in the past. And they were not equally treated. So somewhere along their career, they probably felt that they were not up to the jobs, and they had low expectations of themselves, and probably they had a negative spiral. And so we need to get them up to a place where they feel comfortable about themselves and comfortable enough to manage people. The second challenge that I think was that there are a lot of women around you. And I say women so many times that I actually think that if there were enough men out there that understood that it was important to get women in the workforce, because not because of headcount issues, but because of diversity issues, it would make the job much easier. And the third is, as I mentioned, my experience at the retail company, is that the clients, our customers, actually need a more diverse view of what a financial institution is expected to do. Before the internet, for a securities company, just telling a stock price was value added to a customer. If they call us up and ask the stock price and we answer, that was value added and they were willing to pay money for that. Right now, that's not the case. Value added is a human element, the experience of the person that's giving the advice. And of course, everybody, I'm sure, in this room knows that the more diverse, the more experience you have, the better advice that you can give a client. And I think that's very important. Another element is that, and it's the same in the U.S., and I know that my U.S. colleagues in other companies in the U.S. are facing the same thing, is that financial institutions are not as attractive a place to work for as before. So if we want to hire talent, we need to be in a place where young people, when they join, know that they have, it's a sustainable career. And I think our industry is known for not being a sustainable career. So in order to attract talented people, I think we need to get our act together. I said this again, and I'm going to say it again, is that Abenomics and what Mr. Abe is trying to do is to increase women to 30% by 2020. I feel that there is not enough discussion on why he thinks it's important to do so. I think a lot of it is based on headcount, meaning that the population is falling. So in order to maintain it, we need more people to join the workforce. And I think that is a wrong approach, and it's not sustainable. I think we should put it in a way that diversification is important. And that is the reason why we need different people in our companies, on our boards, in our management, because we need, as a country, to thrive and be a more attractive place to invest and to do business. So that's a really quick rundown of what I wanted to say. And thank you for listening.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. Most interesting, I thought, personally. We'll take questions now. First, from the working press, as usual. Do we have any questions from the working press? I'd like to ask one question myself, if I may, to start the ball rolling, as it were. Mr. Abe has the priority of raising the population or stabilizing the population, increasing the fertility rate is one of the elements of that, since immigration is obviously not going to be popular. So are these two things not going to run into conflict, do you think? His desire to raise the, on the one hand, the number of women in managerial positions in Japan, and his desire to increase the fertility rate. I mean, obviously this is a rather facile comparison, but I wonder whether other people in his party are going to argue to him, do you think, that promoting women is not a good thing to do at this time?
I think there have been various studies in other countries that actually the higher the level of women in the workforce, the higher the fertility rate. I can't name any of the studies, but I think Sweden was mentioned and other countries that have a higher percentage of women in the workforce actually have more children. And I think there's an element of being safe and being comfortable with yourself in order to have children. I don't have children myself, but I can see that. So as you mentioned, I don't think just telling women or telling people to have more kids is going to promote that. They need to be more stable and feel more secure for that to happen. But I don't think it's against each other. I think we can do both at the same time.
Okay, questions, please. Yes.
Oh, this is how it works.
Siegfried Knittel, freelancer from Germany. I have a question not about women in finance business, mm-hmm. more about women in business. Mm-hmm. 2 days ago, I read an article that was an interview with an investment manager from Netherlands. She said in the interview, she made a fund investing in companies with a mixed leadership, man-woman leadership, mm-hmm. because she says mixed leadership have the best result. Mm-hmm. Could you, and a lot of research was made in this, could you tell something about this mixed leadership or women in leadership, men in leadership, what does it make for results?
Yes, I think, as I mentioned, that what I my consideration about Mr. Abe is that the important part is the diversity. That is what makes a company strong or a country strong. And I think that plays into the research that you just mentioned, that having a mixed or diverse group of people managing the company makes it stronger. I can't point to why, but I think it's because more ideas and looking at more various areas of how to grow the business than white male companies.
She says men are too aggressive in investment.
Yes.
And women are less aggressive. Mm-hmm. So the mixture is the best.
Yes. And I think you can say that if you have different nationalities as well as men and women, it would make it more dynamic for the same reason. And I think it will be difficult to get it together to make a decision to invest in certain companies, and that's where the challenge is of having a diverse company. Because in Japan, our strength, I think, in the past has been is aun no koku, meaning that we don't need to communicate, but we can understand each other. And I think that's what people rely on and is said to be Japanese strength. But it's getting more and more difficult.
Okay. If there are no questions immediately from the working press, Dozo, please.
Okay, Judith Staubus from the Netherlands, and I know about whom he's speaking. Oh. She's a very good investor indeed, this lady. But I have a question about the Japanese situation. First, are you also, as there are so little women in leadership positions in Japan, are you also on committees directly advising the government? So could you influence Mr. Abe or one of his many commissions? That's one thing. And about the fertility rate and focusing on women, if you read the commento in all the like change.org or on blogos.com, I think half of the commenters are men. Mm-hmm. I guess they are on the younger part of the society, and they point at this kaksa shakai, on this Piketty effect, mm-hmm. so to speak.
Inequalities.
Inequality, mm-hmm. and so these lower income couples, even if they are a couple, they are not in the, they can't start a family because of the situation. And here we don't hear anything in the whole discussion about this Tokyo metropolitan affair, about this kaksa mondai, which is, I think, at the root of the problem, and which was also mentioned in the petition of change.org by the person who started this petition. Is this going to just going down the drain if you really want to have a higher fertility rate? If I know fertility rate is not your topic, but it's a consequence mm-hmm. of your topic, so to speak.
So in regards to the committee, I actually reside in the U.S. right now, so I'm not okay. not probably. But my company, which is Daiwa, we've been trying to get our act together for the past 10 years. Our chairman, our current chairman, has been a very strong force in trying to get women to remain in the workforce. And I think we're finally seeing the results after 10 years. And it's taken us 10 years to get to the point. And I think how we can influence is the government or Mr. Abe is that it takes time and it takes patience. And it's also that it's not because of headcount. It's because we want the woman in the workforce. And I think we can. I would want to influence the government by making an example, a good example for other companies to follow. Regarding what you mentioned, I totally agree with you. And I was having a discussion with my colleagues in the car coming here. Is actually, even before having kids, getting married, and I think there is actually statistics on that, is that you need to earn a certain amount of money before people get married. There's a threshold, and you can see that threshold in studies. So if you don't earn enough money, people are not getting married. So that's number one. And I think the second one is, if you don't feel comfortable about raising children, you're not going to have kids. And I think there's various ways that the government can try to change that. But it's not just the money element. It's the security and feeling comfortable. And that's not going to happen all of a sudden. So, but I do think it's going to be a very important element in addressing the fertility issue.
Right. Perhaps I could... Do you have a question? I'm sorry. Ask you one more question, if I may, and that is whether you think the situation is better with regard to women outside of the financial field in Japan, in other words, in business corporations. I think it's very interesting. If you travel to Washington, D.C. and visit the World Bank or the IMF, you'll see an awful lot of young Japanese women there in quite senior positions, relatively few Japanese men. But obviously, that women are rising to the opportunities in international institutions. But what about generally the position of women in Japanese business? Is it better or worse than in the financial industry?
I think there is a tendency of it being better, mostly because, well, for retail, because half of their customers are women. There is a tendency, but I don't think there's a lot of room for improvement. And you talked about the World Bank, but as I mentioned, a lot of women feel that it's easier to pursue a career outside of Japan, which is a pity because that's how we're losing a lot of talent. And I think in my age, in my era, women had to make special efforts to remain in the workforce, and we did have a certain element of we needed to try. But you can't tell 30 years down the line, I don't think you can tell women now that they still have to, because they have the option of moving or working wherever they want. And I don't think they have any responsibility to try hard to get into a Japanese company. And I think it's the loss of Japanese companies if the situation continues for further on.
Yeah, my name is Kurt Sieber. I'm an associate member. I don't really have questions, but I would like to underline some of your comments, if you allow me to. The first one is that for the first time at the press club here, tomorrow we have elections of three associate member directors, and we greatly hope that one of the three will be a lady who is in a high managerial position at Otsuka Pharmaceuticals, but we will see tomorrow.
Electioneering, please, sorry.
Yeah, sorry. Anyhow, that was, it's besides the point. What I really want to say is about ladies in the United States. I have four children, three of them are girls, one is a boy. The only one who came back to Japan after their universities in the United States is my boy, because the food, he said, is much better in Japan.
I agree.
But all the three girls, they stayed in the United States, and I would like to refer to one who is in the financial industry. She's a director in one of the M&A companies at Wall Street, and she has three children. She also has two nannies, one from Okinawa and one from Niigata. And every time she has a child, the company is offering her 3 months paid maternity leave. They are very comfortable in their position, and she wouldn't change back to Japan for any amount of money I would be willing to offer her, because we would like them to be closer to our family. Thank you very much.
I think that childcare is an issue, and I think everybody is aware of that. It's probably going to be difficult to address the issue, because getting paid leave is mandatory. So companies are obliged to pay for maternity leave, and I don't think that is the issue. It's getting domestic help onwards, which is the issue.
Yes, please. I didn't mention.
Hello. I was working on investor relations.
I know Mr. Shear for Investor Relations Day, so it's good to see you again. Congratulations on all the success that you've had since you moved on beyond me. My name is Walter Altair. I work for CLSA Securities. And I wanted to see if I could possibly even ask two questions. The first is, some people talk about the concept of women having it all, if you will, having the career, having the family, having the husband, the kids, the whole ball of wax. If you were talking to young women, like the graduating class of university today, would you tell those women, try to have it all, you can't have it all, that's what you should strive for? Or would you tell them, it's very difficult, if not impossible, to have it all, be prepared to make some choices? And then the second question I wanted to ask, if possible, I knew a woman in the securities industry who actually was in her 20s at the time, who said that one of the problems facing some women is that Japanese men don't want to date a woman who earns more money than they do. And if you're in a securities company, particularly in the bull market, of course, that could severely limit your options. In a bear market, you might have a lot of options, but in a bull market, it might be difficult. I was wondering if you've ever heard, either directly through yourself or through any of your acquaintances, of a similar situation.
So the first question, and I would answer, have it all, because there's no reason why you couldn't. And I would think, if you were to ask a man the same thing, I mean, do men think that they have it all?
I personally don't, but I'd love to have it all.
But I think they probably never think that they had to sacrifice something to have it all. And I think it should be the same for women. There's no reason why they couldn't have it all. So that's the answer to you. The second question is, I think there is, but it's changing. If you look at Daiwa, you see lots of couples within the company. They obviously need to know how much they're earning, and they both remain in the company. So I think, and it's changed. I think before, when they married, there was kotobuki taisha, meaning that the woman usually left the company. But now you hardly ever see one of them leave. So I think the situation is changing. Although maybe I wouldn't say it's across the border. I think there are some men that are still wimps.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is James Edna, and I'm an associate member. You mentioned in your talk that a number of your peers had left Japanese institutions to go to foreign financial firms, and it sounds like there were times when you thought very ambiguously about your own career. What made you stay at Daiwa, and do you have any comments on the differences that your peers might have, women working in foreign financial firms, for example?
Thank you. The reason why I stayed is because I had no reason to leave. Because my career has been very interesting in a way that I've been able to change jobs, move to other various cities. I was promoted when I felt that I deserved to be promoted. So my frustrations have been much less than a lot of my other friends. And I think differences, I think there were differences, and that's why they left, is that if they stayed in a Japanese company, more so maybe 20 years ago than now, they would have to fight to be recognized for their potential, or fight to be recognized for what they're doing when they have another male colleague doing like half the job but getting promoted. And I think that's the frustration that they had to fight with. And I think initially they thought that this was what, because it's an era, that they have to do it. But doing it 10 years, they just said, I can't deal with it anymore, and they left. And I think they have all the right to do. And I don't think, it was the company's loss. The company that lost them, it was their loss. I'm not sure if the companies realize this, but.
Hi, I'm Ken Moritsugu with the Associated Press, and I'm from New York, or Long Island, too. So good to see you here in Tokyo.
Good to see you.
I just had a kind of broad question, because obviously there has been some change since the time when you entered in the 1980s in this situation and in all situations. And but we often kind of wrestle with, well, how much obviously hasn't changed enough, and how much has it changed, how much hasn't changed. So I don't know the best way to ask this question, but how would it be, would you say it's different today for, say, a woman either entering, say, in her 20s, entering a company now, or maybe someone in their 30s now, versus what you went through in your career? And I don't know, whatever the best comparison is, it's up to you to make. Thank you.
I think the easiest sense for that is that when I joined the company, there was a Christmas case, meaning that if you didn't marry by 25, no, you weren't worthless. I wouldn't say worthless, but half your worth. I do not think that's the situation anymore. And I also think that there's no kotobuki taisha, meaning you're not expected to leave when you get married. I think there's a lot more women in managerial positions in almost any company compared to what it was 30 years ago. Some companies have progressed more than others. I also think because of the internet and all the information flowing around, that women are aware of the opportunities that they have, and they don't need to stay at where they are stuck. And I think that was a situation for my generation, because they didn't know what else was there opportunity-wise. They stayed and they got very frustrated. And I don't think that's a situation. So opportunities and options are much more wider.
Mitsuya Goto. I'm an old associate member of this club since 1969. I had 5 years of schooling in America and trained in speech. But anyway, in 1969, I was asked to join Nissan Motor Company. And in 1977, Takashi Ishihara was named president. He was finally upgraded by Chairman Kawamata. And he and I went to the Tokyo Motor Show that year. And at the import stand, he saw a good-looking, tall Japanese girl speaking both English and Japanese, explaining what this car is all about. He turned to me and said, why don't we, Nissan, doesn't have girls like that. So since then, I got to train the cream of the crop, a female college graduate that's been hired by Nissan. So I'm always interested in training women. But anyway, a question I want to ask is, will you join this club as an associate member and bring younger generation females who are working for Daiwa Shoken?
I don't know how to answer that question.
I said no electioneering. I should say no advertising too, but please, if you are.
I think this is a great opportunity for me to talk, and I hope that you find whatever I say something interesting.
You've stolen my lines for the last minute.
Thank you for getting a second chance, because it's getting more and more interesting, what you're telling us. It sounds as if there's a kind of dilemma in this whole issue. At the one hand, you say, okay, diversification is the big issue. On the other hand, you also say, just anecdotally, you said, would you have asked a man the same question? Mm-hmm. So the treatment to a man and a woman should be the same. So there should be a sameness, in mm-hmm. like in this equal opportunity, not only, but also in the treatment. Mm-hmm. Is that compatible? If you want to have, they are different people, mm-hmm. you suggest, because mm-hmm. diversification, not in gender, in mm-hmm. culture, in nationality, maybe in languages, etc. On the other hand, you promote a kind of equal or the same mm-hmm. treatment. So how do you then manage women versus men? Do you treat them the same, or do you appreciate the diversity and you treat them differently?
I think, Mike, the question was opportunity, and I think opportunity is the same for anybody, whether it's a woman or a man, because there's people in their lifestyles or lifespans, life cycles. Some people have children, some men and women have children, some men and women don't. Some get sick, some don't. Some have parents that are ill, some don't. So you can't sort of categorize people in situations. So I think if you don't know, you say there's any chance you can get it all. I think for men or women. I think men and women are different, but I think the difference is not because women take care of kids and men don't. And I think that's why what we're talking about is not sustainable. I think parents raise children, women give birth to their, and that is a difference. And I think that should be respected. But I think in raising families, it's not she's raising her family, it's the family. And I think those are the situations that are the same. I think diversification is that the experience of each and every individual is different. So getting them all together is a strength rather than a nuisance, because you have to communicate more. And I think we in Japan need to get used to communicating, because you just can't have aon no kokyu and understand each other by sharing the same experiences. I think, I'm not sure if I'm making myself clear, but so I think they are interlinked, but there is a difference.
Getting towards the end of our time, but I'd like to ask you one final question. In the anteroom, I asked you whether you were optimistic about Japan. Mm-hmm. You said you were optimistic about the economy, but you were not so optimistic about social issues. Can you just say what you meant by that in relation to this subject? I mean, do you think the mindset of most people in Japan is still fundamentally opposed to seeing women rise in business or in any other sphere? Or, I mean, it's all right, easy for us here. We're a group of internationally minded people in this room. But do you think that basically that you're still struggling against a very sort of conservative or reactionary mindset in this country?
I do, because I think people... The people in Japan, there's a seniority system, and the people that are making the decisions tend to be more not as flexible as the younger generation. And I think that's where I mean by the economy, we've learned our lessons and we're progressing, but the social issues that we have, not just about women, but all the population, immigration, these are issues that we need to talk about, and we're not even in a position to really talk about the issues outright yet. And maybe it's because I live in the U.S. and I'm not seeing it, and it's difficult to see what's happening in Japan from the U.S., but I think we need to really sit down and ask ourselves why we need more women in management. Is it because otherwise it seems that it's just a number issue. The population is falling. We need more people working. Thus, we need women who are not working, working. And I don't think that's the right, I don't think that's the reason why we need more women in the workforce. And that's why I think I have concerns about the social elements.
Thank you. Very useful. Time for a final question. Anyone? Yes. I think you raised your hand first.
I think one is a discussion to bring women more in business. But I think there is also in Japan a kind of culture of kawaii.
Kawaii.
Kawaii. And I think kawaii and women in business, this is totally opposite. is it not necessary to change this kind of image of women to be cute, kawaii, this is... to make women really stronger, is it not necessary for bringing women in business?
I actually, before I went to start working in the U.S., I thought exactly the same, but having gone to the U.S. and seeing what's on TV and visiting some places outside of New York. There is actually an element of kawaii in the U.S. as well, that they want women to be cute. I mean, the concept of blonde and blue-eyed is sort of like kawaii. And there is an element of that. So I don't think, maybe it's stronger in Japan, but, and I don't know in your country, but there is an element of that that is still living. And I think that, I don't know if, I think women are actually smart enough to fake it, if that's what's necessary to succeed. I think they've gone over that point. I'm just talking, but I think that I think it's true. But I think that we can actually play it a bit more than we did before.
I just wondered whether you'd had any experience in graduate recruitment, and the question is basically, how do you view young Japanese women today? There's a lot of talk in the press that, you know, young Japanese in general are less ambitious, less, internationally oriented. Are you optimistic or pessimistic about young Japanese women's ambitions in the workplace?
So I actually, and I don't, I've heard of the less ambitious and people wanting to be housewives, but I also think that the flip side is the reason why they say they want to be housewives is that it's not going to happen. In my generation, people wouldn't say they want to be housewives because they thought that's what they were going to be. So I'm not. I think it's changed in a way that they know they want don't. I mean, they can't be housewives, and there's various reasons why they can't. But the other side is, I've heard that the number is 30%, which means that 70% don't want to be housewives, and that's a big figure. So 30 is actually, it seems big, but it's probably not compared to. So I think the direction is actually not going backwards. I think it's actually progressive, even if it's 30%. Okay.
Just one final question over there.
Since you went past the other last question, I thought I would try. What we understand is the importance of having male champions of change. You've talked about how your chairman is very visionary and supportive. Do you have any helpful hints on how to engage men in the discussion?
Ah, good question. I'm still working on it, and I'm struggling because they are smart enough to have a discussion. I don't know if they really mean it or not. And I think some men will, their private lives and their business lives are different, so they will differentiate, and it's fine. But that's why I find it difficult if they're really mean it or they're not. So I think we should have this discussion when we get back to New York.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
That's a good question.
You've had a severe...
Very strict. 7 o'clock.
You've had a severe grilling, and you stood up to it very well. Thank you for widening our horizons, especially the mere men among the audience. We're very grateful to you. We hope you'll come back again on your next visit to Japan, and we're going to give you, as usual, a one-year honorary membership to the club in the hope that you'll come back often and talk to us again. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.